Welcome to the Double D Wrestlecast. My name is Steve.
Rich.
What's wrong with the Double D?
Nothing. I love Double Ds.
I love Double Ds as well.
I look like one.
And this is our premiere episode where we are going to give our preview for the WWE pay-per-view Payback that's occurring this Sunday on the WWE Network for only $9.99. But if you sign up, if you never signed up, you get it for free.
Non-sponsored content.
$9.99. But first, we're going to give our WrestleMania reactions. Because again, it was the biggest night of the year. I think the pay-per-view is still happening right now. The longest wrestling pay-per-view ever.
That's my SummerSlam gimmick. Don't steal that.
The SummerSlam gimmick, yes. So Rich, what was your first... Well, actually, what are your impressions, overall impressions of this year's WrestleMania?
It was an okay show. Better than last year. But nothing really blew me away. Of course, everybody's going to miss The Undertaker, but... That match was not the way to go out, but it kind of does make the story work that it was time for him to go out, so it kind of worked that way. Just glad he got to say goodbye. I do appreciate that because he's been going for better part of 3 decades, so.
Been the Undertaker since 1990. And then how long was he in WCW?
Not that long, but you know, he'd been on the independents and stuff before that, so, but WWE was home. Although, pay attention, there's plenty of good stories online of how Nash and Hall almost got him to jump to WCW back in the day, around the time when Brett did, so.
Brett screwed Brett.
No, Brett did not screw Brett.
No. But there wasn't that classic five-star match.
No, and he's been, it's one of those, everybody talks about, they've thought that it was going to be his last match every single year, and he kept having these barn burners year after year after year. It was the go-to match. That's as much as I agree with CM Punk's opinion of he should have main evented Mania. I kind of get why Hunter and Vince would tell him that, you know, you've got a match with The Undertaker at WrestleMania. You should be happy. That's a main event. I agree with his point. The last match is the main event, but I get why they thought, no, you're going to be a headliner, so...
But he wanted to be that last match.
He did, and I get that. That's a respect thing. That's why we think the women's revolution like tonight on SmackDown. And with the women's match for the first time on SmackDown, that's a big step forward. But it's a big step forward because we all go, women main evented SmackDown Live for the first time. So he's got a point, even in the company's psychology.
So we're going to run down the show really quick. Starting with the pre-show, this was my first time watching Austin Aries. My first time watching him wrestle.
Ring of Honor, Impact, yeah.
I don't know much about him.
He's the greatest man that ever lived.
I just know something happened to his eye socket.
Right? Yeah, Shinsuke Nakamura. That's what happened to his eye socket.
Really?
King of Strong Style.
He was the one.
Yep.
Fantastic. That's good to know. And Strong Style actually is
true. It's actually, yeah, he was an MMA fighter, so that's legit.
Surprised that he did lose. But again, he's getting a rematch at Payback, which he'll more than likely win. We'll get into that later. One question is Mojo winning the Battle Royal. I don't understand. Is it just to get headlines with Gronk?
I would assume so, yeah. And you need to do something with him because they, with Zach going down with his knee injury, they had to do something to build him up and try. And it sounds like they're going to split him single full time even when Ryder comes back. So it does kind of make sense to try to use that momentum. But like we saw tonight, nothing happened. So. Couple weeks removed, and they've already kind of forgotten. When Gronk's not around, there's no reason to put him on the show, which is sad. He's got potential, but I think it needs to be fine-tuned. He needs a little bit of a leash. That's why putting him with Ryder was a good idea, but unfortunately, Zach got hurt.
And the one thing is, I'm starting to accept this, which you've accepted since the first Andre the Giant Battle Royals. I was making it a bigger deal than it was. As in, people win it, it should be that big match to get him to the next level. But you've said it since day one when they first, that it doesn't mean anything.
Well, it can. I get where you're coming from. It can, and maybe even it should. But that's not the methodology. They're trying to use it as an excuse, kind of like when they do the IC ladder matches or how Money in the Bank first started when it was a match on WrestleMania as opposed to its own pay-per-view. Trying to get a way to get everybody paid. Get them all that gate money as opposed to just, you know, their regular, you're under salary. And when you have the chance to put 20 guys out there, that's why they did the Royal Rumble originally. It's because a Battle Royal is a good way to get 20 or 30 guys a paycheck. So
it's WrestleMania. just that's get the biggest payday of the year for most of them. 75,000 supposedly fans that was there.
That's non-rigged. No, that's completely true. Yeah.
Universal fact.
Yes.
It's our universal fact. Then Dean Ambrose versus Baron Corbin for the Intercontinental Championship. I love that The Miz actually brought this up, I believe, last week on SmackDown. As in, you went from WWE Champion to 6 months on the pre-show to WrestleMania. What has happened to Dean Ambrose?
Well, the worst part of that is that Dean should have called into question what happened when Miz did the same exact thing.
He actually, Miz main evented WrestleMania with John Cena.
And left with the belt. He won.
But he got overshadowed with Cena Rock.
And as he should, but
yeah,
they did the same thing and he loses it the next pay-per-view and never recovered until pretty much the last year is when he's finally...
He's been on a hot run.
...climbing back up now. Even before Maurice, he was starting to build up his stature again, but Maurice has put it over the top for him. I'm hoping this move to Raw is beneficial, but moving him away from Lana and Rusev was good if you were going to keep both of those teams heel, but I thought that could have been some money, putting those two groups together.
What do you think of Baron Corbin so far?
He's got the right size. He's got
that Vince McMahon loves.
Yeah, he's got the ability, but I don't think he's got the look. I don't think he's got the temperament, and he certainly didn't have the promo skills.
The lone wolf.
I don't get what his thing is. I mean, he seems like a good dude if you want to go to a fucking thrash concert, but that doesn't mean I want to pay to see him in a main event, and that's the problem. I'll be honest. I brought up before, Zack Ryder, I don't think he should be main event either. I love Zack, but between those two, I'd go see a Ryder main event light years before I'd go see Baron Corbin in a main event. It's just how I feel.
I'm kind of happy that Dean Ambrose went over Baron. I don't think it's Baron's time yet. Looks like they're pushing him maybe for Randy Orton opponent.
But he'll be over the summer. Yeah.
Money in the Bank. Hopefully SummerSlam, Orton, AJ Styles. Hopefully they are leading to that. Then let's get to the main card, opening up, speaking of AJ Styles, with his match with Shane McMahon. And now after post-WrestleMania, both years, the story with Shane McMahon makes absolutely zero sense.
Yep.
Last year with The Undertaker, if he wins, he gets control of Raw,
yeah,
I believe.
Yeah.
And then he loses, but he still became the GM the day
he's
after.
He's got that lockbox of potential, I guess, blackmailable items that we have no idea what the context that is lockbox. Other than... Vince obviously is a man that has secrets, so they had the sense to imply that he had done something, but then didn't actually go through with it. Because usually they'll just flat out tell you, like, oh no, he cheated on his wife, or, you know, had this little angle with one of the divas, or...
Or had Hornswoggle as a bastard.
Or he was the secret power the whole time.
It's going way back.
Yeah.
What did you think of the match, AJ Styles versus... Shane McMahon?
Better than expected. Shane's still going what he should. I still do agree that was not the right spot for AJ, but AJ's trying to show he's a company man, and that's kind of been what we were all worried about when he didn't get picked up right away and went to Japan after TNA. And when he came in, I don't know that I believe Ryback's version of events, but he likes to tell people that when AJ came in, Vince was patting him on the back of, yeah, go squash that hillbilly. Let's teach him a lesson. AJ can go, though. So, all of a sudden, Vince saw that there was money to be made, and the kid has talent, and he's charismatic. He was over with the fans even when you were trying to, like, make him look a little bit bad. And he was willing to do, you know, you have your match with Jericho, and he put Jericho over.
At last year's WrestleMania.
Yeah, so he's doing the right things, and with Shane, I think that was, they probably set that up to see what his reaction was going to be. And when he was like, whatever you need, boss, I'm there. That's when they said, okay, well, you're going to win then.
Where would you rather... Who would you have faced at WrestleMania?
I would have brought in Shinsuke or Joe earlier, put him on SmackDown, and built that for a month and a half, and then have the big blowout at WrestleMania.
Because neither Joe or Finn was on the card.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
They were available. They were
both
available.
Yep, they were both ready and available.
And they
did
not
even,
put them...
They had even introduced Joe. So yeah. The fact that he didn't even show up for a run-in or anything... Or even backstage, to have him be like, I'm going to be watching your match, Seth... And then we're all waiting for Joe to get involved, and then Seth beats Hunter clean. That could have been a storyline thing. You could have used that for momentum of Joe versus Triple H, or Triple H was getting too cocky and told Joe, I don't need you for once. I'm going to show you how it's done. So there's so many possibilities there that could have led to what they're doing now, which is Rollins versus Joe.
And we can go down to the next match that was on the Kevin Owens versus Chris Jericho for the United States Championship. And we were there on the Monday Night Raw in Las Vegas.
The Festival of Friendship.
Yeah. Yes. With the finger. Best poster ever. I'm going to put that in the background. That will be our background poster.
I hope you do. Poster. I am never advocated something more than that idea right there.
That will be on. That will be our background.
It should go right above
the
us.
Poster.
Mo is going to love that.
And Mo, if you haven't seen, we have another podcast, the PPVG, the Passionate Playing Video Gamers, with Mo as our third.
We're on the same channel. Of course, us. They watch all our content.
Exactly.
That's why you like, subscribe, comment below, check out our Patreon, buy our t-shirts.
So we were heavily invested since we were there at the end for the Festival of Friendship. Chris Jericho being thrown to the TV, which we already knew was going to happen because they were stacking like sand bags in the TV, right?
Yeah.
Below in the box. So we knew someone was going through.
He's giving away the secrets.
Oh, the secrets. Yes.
Kayfabe.
During the commercial break. My bad. I don't know. I guess I expected more. I don't know. I guess my hopes was so high. It was still a good match. I enjoyed it, but I just expected more.
No, but bringing back Jericho the way that they did with the whole he had to drop the belt to Goldberg, I think that took some of the steam out of it. I mentioned it before. I don't think that they should have taken the belt off of him. I like that Jericho had the U.S. title, but I don't think that was the right spot for that title. And I think that it would have meant more if they had the Universal title.
Yeah, you felt it should have been the Universal.
Goldberg didn't need it. Lesnar certainly doesn't need it now. And right now...
Who's Lesnar?
Exactly.
I haven't seen him.
Nobody's talking about him on Raw. Nobody's challenging him. He actually named his challenger and then disappeared.
No one's talking
about him. His challenger's too busy fighting somebody else.
It makes
sense.
And
this is the problem that we have. This is the CM Punk problem. I'm going to refer back to that again, where John Cena was more important than the belt. I get that where you've invested, he's paid his dues, but we're supposed to believe that the MacGuffin is the most important thing. That's what they're all fighting for. That's why John's even there, is to prove that he should be the champion. Well, if John doesn't need the championship, then why the fuck is he there? Why doesn't he go make movies full time? Because he's obviously more important.
He's
than
making
the
babies now, getting married.
He's having kids, but yeah.
And then the next match, the Fatal 4-Way for the Raw Women's Championship, where Bayley actually won.
Surprisingly, yeah. But that's good. I like that.
I like that Bayley won, defeated Charlotte Flair, Nia Jax, and Sasha Banks. Again, everyone is talking about that Charlotte Flair should have lost the title here to make it that WrestleMania
moment.
That would
have been a better moment, yeah. We were also there. That was the same night, Festival of Friendship, when Bayley won the championship.
When Bayley won the championship. I enjoyed the triple threat match the year before better.
Where Flair was there?
With had Becky Lynch, Sasha, and Charlotte. On their triple threat. Nia Jax, it was elimination, so I enjoyed elimination to get Nia Jax out of there quickly. What do you think what they're doing with Sasha? What do you think the heel turn is happening?
SummerSlam or the build to SummerSlam. SummerSlam will be the payoff for that feud.
Again, I don't watch NXT, so I didn't know anything about Bayley or Sasha or even Charlotte. Or was Nia in NXT?
Yeah, but not quite the same thing. She's kind of the class below them.
I know Richie watches the takeovers, the NXTs. I haven't watched any of them. He showed me a few matches. You show me the four horsewomen match.
And what else did we watch? Oh, we watched Shinsuke's debut against Sammy, which hopefully they're building for again. And then we watched DIY versus The Revival.
So again, I have no knowledge of Bayley until she came on to Raw. And again, they hit it home how it's her dream match.
Which is part of the problem. It's just like... I think Sasha's one of the most talented performers, but certainly one of the most talented female performers. And she is excellent on the mic when she's a heel. When she's a baby face, it's kind of cringeworthy many times. When she keeps doing the, listen, sweetheart, and then Charlotte says, who are you calling sweetheart? And she goes, I'm calling you sweetheart. I don't... I need something more. I keep hearing how you're Snoop Dogg's cousin. Can he write you some
You can call me sweetheart. I don't mind.
No, sweetheart. Not going to do it, sweetie.
Sorry, sweetheart.
Yeah. It's not working. And that's part... She's not comfortable with that. And that's part of it. They need to be comfortable. That's the Baron Corbin thing. You're not comfortable with that. And that's the sad thing, is that's his personality. And he's still not comfortable with it.
But I can see... I guess I don't mind if Charlotte Flair was going in as champion. It would have been, I guess, too obvious that Bayley was going to win the title. It was all set up. But again, create that WrestleMania moment, and now I guess...
But who cares about obvious? Sometimes knowing what the ending's going to be will draw the people in.
It's the journey to get there, not the destination.
Yeah.
That she's going to win the title, but it's a journey to get that moment.
You're going
to
have fun. Like the Hangover. After you watch the first one... The reason why everybody watched those two subpar sequels is because they knew it was standard movie for 10 minutes, then the, oh my god, what did we do last night? And then the slow build to eventually they find their missing friend and they're all back together and all's well for the next event.
Spoiler alert, they find their friend at the end. The hell? The next...
Three times.
The next is the ladder match that got thrown in like the last week. The Raw Tag Team Championship. Supposed to be a triple threat, and then it's a ladder match now.
Yeah, you know why? That was clearly to build the Hardys. That was the best moment of the night. Was the Hardys?
And again, I have no prior knowledge of this delete gimmick. No prior knowledge.
I gotta watch how I do that, especially with this angle, this haircut. Delete. I'm clearly saying delete.
Delete. I have no knowledge. I have no idea what it's about. Rich tried to explain to me. It makes no sense to me. I don't get it.
Because it takes you a long time to explain it.
Yeah. Well, it takes a lot for you to explain things anyways.
Well, that's just me.
accurate. The Hardy Boys, new Raw Tag Team Champions. Great way to introduce them. It's been years. I forgot how many years they said on Raw, how many years they've been gone. Where have they been? The Hardy Boys.
Oh, we don't talk about that. Ask JBL.
Oh, that's... Ooh. Too soon.
Which is funny, tonight when he was talking about Shinsuke's accomplishments being the youngest IGWP champion in that history, that didn't happen in WWE. I don't know why that counts. I'd ask his cohort, but he's not sitting next to him anymore.
He's done. No.
I don't know what you're talking about. We don't talk about that. No, he's still under contract until August. I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
That's all rumors and speculation. We don't comment on that.
But again, a ladder match... Always a spot fest, but always great to have a ladder match at WrestleMania. Get the crowd going. Were you impressed with the ladder match?
I as a guy that was watching what was going on in Ring of Honor and Impact, seeing them actually come out and win the titles again, so the Expedition of Gold was successful, that was worth it for me. Although I wouldn't have, I know it was like a last minute and they actually... We're doing shows the night before, and they did like a tailgate thing earlier in the day. It still would have been nice if Matt could have got the white streak out of his hair, because if they are going to bring back the broken gimmick, which everybody's talking about that it sounds like they're going to, it only makes sense to have him come back as, you know, Millionaire Matt kind of thing, or the Hardys, and then have him get broken, and all of a sudden he's got the white streak and his condition. I think that's the way to go, because... As somebody who doesn't know, when you see that white streak, you go, what the fuck is wrong with Matt Hardy, right? And that's part of why...
I've been saying that since I've known him.
But that's part of what is going on with, apparently, with Vince. He wants to put Jeff into the world title picture. Matt's not being discussed. Matt's been up there, too.
Matt's always been secondary to Jeff.
In Vince's eyes?
No, I would watch Jeff over Matt.
I know, because you're not familiar with some of the other stuff he does. No, in WWE parlance, I agree with you.
Yeah, but in WWE, when Jeff Hardy got his title run, I absolutely agreed that he got the push over Matt.
But that's because you were seeing what they were doing there. That's he had been pigeonholed because he didn't have the same look as Jeff. Jeff is the flashier of the two.
Yeah.
So he, you know, he got Jannetty'd.
I think he's more exciting.
Jeff. But the Broken Universe clearly shows he's not Jannetty. He's not. He's got potential. I'm not saying.
Can he put on great matches, or is it just the gimmick?
No, he puts on some good matches. There's a lot of good psychology. That's why the whole broken thing works so well, is because there's so many intricate different layers and inside references and jokes. Like, I know you don't really like the club. I love watching them out there. When Gallows and Anderson are slipping in jokes or spots and stuff that they're doing, I think that's hilarious. but you don't always get the reference. So you're just like, oh, hard-boiled eggs, and I get it. That was horrible comedy. It shouldn't be on any show. But especially those guys who are genuinely funny. Watch South by. You'll see. They actually know how to tell a joke. They know how to do a funny bit.
Again, with someone with no prior knowledge of Anderson and Gallows, again, I'm not impressed with them as a tag team.
But it's how they're being used. Yeah. The same thing with Primo and Epico. The Colognes are some of the best wrestlers from Latin America. They're what, third generation in Puerto Rico? And what are they? They're timeshare salesmen. And now that gimmick burned out too. What a surprise. Or like Titus. Titus obviously has a good reputation backstage. We both, I don't want to speak for you, but I think that you're probably going to agree with this when I say it. Titus is a waste, and I can't believe he's still on the roster. Especially after that thing a couple years
ago. He does great deeds, you know, with the Make-A-Wish.
And so does everybody. It's almost mandatory for the company now. So I don't get why he's there. Now you're giving him Abraham Washington's whole gimmick?
As in their campaign for Stop Bowling?
Yeah, exactly.
JBO?
Exactly. My God.
The next up is the match we've been waiting for. John Cena and Nikki Bella versus The Miz and Maryse.
No, when you said that jokingly, but that was probably the strongest build of almost any of these. And with only a month, and we knew, what, 3 or 4 months ahead of time that that's the direction they were going.
Those are some great promos.
Yeah.
Those were...
Miz is a guy that has been pigeonholed because of his reputation and his background on the real world and stuff like that. But when you give him the ball, whether it's talking smack, he is
consistent. Oh, with the Daniel Bryan.
Yeah, he's consistent in the ring. He can work heel by himself in a tag team or with a valet. He gets genuine heat. And he does get them in the palm of his hand. He knows how what he's doing. He actually has picked up his game quite a bit. A lot more than I ever thought he'd be able to do from that fan mentality getting to actually carry the belt. I mean, I want him in the world title picture. He deserves to be there. He's been working his ass off.
Whenever the Universal title comes back.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
That's not a thing.
We'll see. Again, the match was... So I just hope The Miz does not get buried in Raw, and that's what Cena does. I'm really upset that someone gets built up. Rusev, huge streak, and Bray Wyatt going in hot. That was the first one, actually, was Bray Wyatt going in
and
hot to WrestleMania.
It wasn't until last night where he interfered, and we finally were like, oh, he's got some potential.
Yeah, that Bray Wyatt should have gone over on Cena at WrestleMania, even though he won the next pay-per-view in a steel cage, but he lost the feud. And then also the year after was Rusev. Again, putting these new up-and-comers with Cena, against Vince McMahon feels that's enough. Hey, you're in a match with John Cena at WrestleMania. You're getting a rub. Even though you're losing, but you're getting the eyes. Like, no.
He didn't understand that's what gives them that reputation. That's why Dolph Ziggler, one of the strongest performers that they have, but they pigeonholed him into that where now he's the smaller version of the Big Show because he's flipped and flopped, whether he's heel or face. He's always, is he charismatic or is he hateful? Is he pick up the chicks or chicks are screwing him over to go back to Rusev? And it makes no sense. And he busts his ass. What they did on SmackDown tonight was disrespectful to him and Shinsuke. That was just a horrible bit tonight. Yeah, and this is a guy that I think if he got to see what Shinsuke was capable of, would completely buy into it. But right now how he's being presented, he just thinks that he's the flamboyant, dumb character that can't talk, and he hasn't seen him in a match other than when I showed him from that TakeOver Dallas show. That's the only action you've seen him trying to do a Kinshasa tonight, and Ziggler ducked out of the way. I can see why we're almost a month in with his debut, and you're going, why do I care? But here's the problem.
What is so special about him?
But here's the thing. You've never seen him in the entire arena. I understand the smart fans, the night after WrestleMania, they all know his theme song because they're smart fans.
I love his theme song, actually.
But the people the next night or the next week, they knew it. And the week after that and tonight, they're all cheering. They all are on board until you continue to book like this. And then eventually they're going to go, I love this entrance. And then when he leaves, like that, if you notice, until probably maybe the last 3 to 6 months, his music would hit and there would be that shield pop and you would notice in the crowd, people look to see, are they walking through the seats towards the ring? And then they remembered, oh, that's not the shield music, that's Roman's music. And then the chorus of boos starts in. But originally, if you're paying attention, those first 2 seconds are because they know that it's on now, and then they go, oh, but it's Roman. Fuck this.
How long until the Shield is reunited?
Well, they're all on Raw now, so
do it. It's time.
No, the last one was way too soon. Let's not do it again.
It was just a one night, right? One match.
It still was too much.
I can see that. Give it some time.
No, if they put Finn with the club and do that, I'd totally buy that.
Well, he fought against the club this past Monday.
I think there could be a story there, but I guess he gets the concussion.
No, I thought they were going to lean towards something with it, but they didn't go. But again, the proposal, which everyone saw.
This is 2 times since he's come back where somebody was out with an injury and Finn apparently wasn't booked that night and just was slid into that slot. Isn't that kind of convenient? But that would be smart booking to notice that kind of thing going on, like many of your smart fans, and then start booking. Well, there's a storyline possibility, but here's what it probably was. He probably passed the concussion testing, but they're still a little iffy, so they don't want to give him too much. He took one bump on Monday night. Probably just him trying to show the office, like, no, I'm good. Or to try to be realistic, or they said, you can take one or two, but don't do anything. Don't do any flips to the outside kind of stuff. So he did a bump or two, but nothing huge. So that he could basically go, no, I'm fine, but he's probably still stinging.
Yeah. But we had the proposal after the match. Again, Miz, I hope he does not get buried like Rusev and Wyatt. It looks like they moved him to Raw. Looks like he's still getting those promos. But again, the proposal, everyone saw coming. Good, happy for John Cena and Nikki Bella. That's all. Again, you propose in front of 75,000 people, universal fact. And
it was the moment they wanted.
Haven't even seen him. Again, they got the buzz. They got the news. It'll be great on Total Bellas next season.
Yeah.
Whenever the show. And then after that, the Seth Rollins and Triple H match, which was the longest match on the card, which is a common theme with Triple H.
Yes, it is.
Always having the longest match on the card. Winners against Sting, the longest match.
Well, that one had 6 other participants, though, by the end. Just saying. I'm the biggest Triple H of all.
He loves Triple H.
Nobody's going to know. But yeah, that's some hot garbage, I'll be honest.
Zeus, come on.
What did you think of Seth Rollins versus Triple H? Over 30 minutes of action.
Went too long. It was all right.
Incredibly too long. Which was the theme of the show.
I'm trying to remember who brought it up. One of the podcasters was bringing up it didn't make sense that Seth came out with a torch and then lit the entryway, which I guess was a cool, like,
passing the torch.
Viking funeral. But yeah, passing the torch, but no, you're taking the torch. Oh, and everybody, just a little side note since we're talking about Rollins, everybody's freaking out. It's something you don't know. Kenny Omega, member of the club and the Elite. When Rollins won on Monday, he was using one of Kenny's signature moves. So the big knee to the clavicle. So everybody's, he stole that.
Better than knee to the nose, John Cena.
That was the other meme from that. He didn't steal that. He knows Kenny. He was trying to troll everybody, saying he could possibly be a participant in the Royal Rumble this last year. That's what the guys do. Just let him have it. It's not like Kenny has any gaps or inability to make new moves or get shit over, and he's not coming to the company anytime soon anyways. So
I'm a big Seth Rollins fan. He's probably one of my favorite wrestlers on the roster right now. AJ Styles and Seth Rollins. I hope that happens at WrestleMania. I think that would be huge.
But Seth is one of those guys that if he weren't at the top of the card because of the Shield and because of the Roman suspension and stuff, they ran the risk of ruining that potential. Because look how quickly they made him a third banana with the Authority. And he's got dildos and vibrators and stuff and his money in the bank and all that. That's stuff that hurts a guy long term. And he's come back from it, but then he comes back from
and not
from
his
injury.
Dick pics?
We didn't know about that. That didn't happen
on
TV.
Okay.
But he comes back from injury. He gets the huge nostalgia of welcome back pop. And they don't turn him face, but then within 3 months they're trying to go that way. Why didn't you do it when strike when the iron's hot? Why are you behind the trends? We're telling you
what
we're willing to accept.
Hasn't Vince McMahon been behind the trends for the last 5 years?
But he's still making money, so that's why he's okay with it because he thinks that he's
leading us. They
will
always make money.
He thinks that he's leading us. Yeah, exactly. But that doesn't mean it's good.
True.
It's an abusive relationship. And we just keep excusing why he keeps hitting us. It's only because he loves us. That's all.
Match went way too long. They should have cut 7-8 minutes, maybe 20-minute match. Even with his knee.
It should have been less. Yeah, I would have worked that the injury should have gone faster.
Do you think Triple H should have gone over, though?
No. Absolutely not.
Doesn't that make Triple H look weak? That Seth Rollins was out and he comes back.
Triple H happily. Is not on the active roster, so...
But Triple H is a god.
He's my god, but he's still not a god.
With the worst losing record in the history of WrestleMania.
Well, that's where everybody talks about burying people, but when it comes to that, he puts people over, doesn't
he? He buries people for the 11 months of the year.
Yeah, and then on the biggest stage when they have the most eyes on them, including the 75,000 Universal fact participants, he puts them over.
Which is what I would prefer, the opposite of John Cena. Well, John Cena just wins.
Yeah, all the time. He wins regardless.
Yeah. So, and then after that, we had Randy Orton and Bray Wyatt for the WWE Championship match. With the holograms on the ring. They showed that two or three times.
I thought that was a good idea, but it was not used properly. Right. I'm not a Randy Orton fan in the least.
Not at all.
What they've done to Bray Wyatt, again, 50-50 booking, has kind of ruined what he is, or the potential he had. When he was converting people in NXT, when they were first building up that whole thing, that was brilliant. The only time that they've really gone after that has been Daniel Bryan and now Randy Orton. And both Daniel Bryan, they burned through it really quick. Randy, that's why this story was built up so well, but then taking the belt off of Bray doesn't make any sense other than you want the face to win.
But that storyline didn't make sense at all, as in I give up my Royal Rumble championship match and then AJ Styles gets a no more contender and like, oh wait, JK, it was all part of the plan.
And I'm turning
6 months
on
ago.
You and yeah.
I'm gonna burn your house.
Abigail's ashes and her bones or whatever. Yeah.
It shouldn't even have happened. It should have been, all right, you lost it. That was your fault. They should have had the story differently leading into that match, how he got into it rather than because he gave it up. That means it's done. That's on him. He should have came up with a different way, as in the night after, burn it, I guess, but he said
that. No, but they think that that's going to be the heat maker, is knowing going into the match that here's your face and here's your heel, where I think it would have made more sense to have a three-way dance where it's...
With AJ?
No. Well, AJ could have been in there too. But you could have either done Harper, AJ challenging Bray, and then Bray, being the heel, uses his, whatever, his abilities or just going and talking and this isn't fair and blah, 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 blah. Even if it's, you could even tell the story that Randy won the Rumble, but Randy sacrifices it. So then when AJ wins it, he says, that's not fair. Let me put Randy in there because he did win that. You don't have that runoff match between AJ and Randy. Maybe you had Harper versus Randy.
They saved that spot that AJ did for another time.
And then you have those
three.
Which
is probably one of the best moves I've seen.
Well, then you
get,
I like the AJ idea. So you got AJ in there and you got Bray. And then Randy's in there because Bray thinks that he's adding him so that it's almost a handicap match. But it's still always been told it's a three-way dance. And then Randy out of nowhere gets an RKO and pins him. And all of a sudden, guess what, Bray? I'm burning your whole empire down. I killed you from within.
I love that. That would have been fucking cool. As in, it's three-way, like, Randy Orton telling Bray Wyatt, we got this.
Yeah,
it's 2-on-1.
They could even team
up
on him and take AJ out.
Yeah.
And then they're, like, celebrating. And, you know, Bray goes for one of his spots when he's posing, and that's when Randy hits him with it and pins him. Boom. And you're like, oh, shit, what just happened?
No, as in, yeah, Orton, then he goes on his back, as in, you pinned me, we took him down. I'm going to let you win.
Oh, then, that's a good way to use that. On his back, and he hits the RKO.
And on his back, as in, all right, we took care of AJ, now it's you and me.
Yeah, they can even redo the finger poke of doom. And
yes.
He lays down.
He does the finger poke of doom.
Like, and then Randy just
and
hits
then
him.
Orton hits the RKO. That is
See,
fucking
look at
beautiful.
How good that was in 30 seconds of thinking. Because I didn't even come to the table with that. I thought of that while we were talking. And then he made it even better. Fucking A.
That would have been fucking incredible.
How is it a team
incredible?
Of riders don't know this?
That would have been incredible. If
and I was using
that.
their bad stuff that they had set up. I only changed one thing.
But it made no fucking sense of how, and it was underwhelming. It was the 10 to 12 minute match.
And
Orton won.
It trotted on and it didn't really make sense. And
it was
in
lost
the end,
in the shuffle.
For Bray to break out these new dark powers and they didn't mean anything, it's kind of a waste.
Got lost in the shuffle.
Yeah.
Then after that let it was the Brock Lesnar Goldberg for the Universal Championship. The one thing we don't agree on is I'm actually glad that it was for the Universal Championship. I understand that there was no reason to put the title on Goldberg and beat Kevin Owens. I get that. It, I guess, create more interest that there's a now title on the line, but I completely understand that it was a waste of Kevin Owens and Chris Jericho. I understand that. For some reason, it created more intrigue for me, and the match was actually better than I thought it was going to be.
But, okay, so do you think that anybody that was on the fence when they found out that Goldberg-Lesnar was happening again, but were still on the fence, but then went, oh, it's for that brand new title that doesn't even have a full year of history behind it? Looks like a fruit roll-up? Now I'm in. Take my money, please. I like fruit roll-ups. So do I, but not for $10.
$9.99.
And not with a couple of 50-year-olds fighting over it. Better than expected.
Yeah, it was better than I.
They did justice.
Really enjoyed it.
And for the first time, Goldberg won clean. Or he lost clean. That's the first clean loss he's ever suffered.
And now he's out, and Brock Lesnar came next night on Raw, and nowhere to be seen.
They were able to fix everything. So now if they want to do a Legends contract with him or bring him into the Hall of Fame, I think the animosity is kind of put aside. He's matured. They've forgiven. They all did good business. They all made good money. He showed he still got it because, let's be honest, he's still a hoss. He still showed he's got it, so... He wasn't perfect. He was able to laugh at himself, too, when he made those little mistakes here and there. So
with the headbutt, with the blood.
He went with it. We all ate it up. Let's be honest. I was a Goldberg fan from WCW, but I always knew that he was a one-trick pony. But I have a lot more respect for him as a performer now.
One of the best-booked wrestlers.
Yeah, superstars. That was good. And you know what? Brock was a great partner for him in that, too. That's showing Brock knows how to do business, too, which is one of those complaints that he gets.
And Brock Lesnar, he was the one, I don't know if it's true, I was reading that he had a lot of creative control of the, and then it was Brock Lesnar's idea was to put Goldberg look so strong.
Yep.
Beat him at the Survivor Series, take him out the realm. But even though he knew he was going to go over at Mania, but what Goldberg.
Heyman told him some bullet points on here's what you need to address. Yeah. Because Goldberg's never been known for cutting a promo anyways. And he didn't do the best because he wasn't comfortable at it. But he was making solid points and he had some good one-liners. So either way, they teed it up and he knocked it right out of the park. So
and then the pee break, the SmackDown Women's Championship.
The only reason this is the pee break is because it's the women's match, but don't think of it that way. I'm disappointed, though, they gave away that Naomi was cleared to compete before this. Because we knew it was a possibility. If they had done the introducing all the competitors and they're all in there, and then JoJo calls out one more... All of a sudden Naomi comes out and the hometown crowd Stacey pops Keebler. For her and she wins. That would have been good, but giving it away the week before again. Who was on the fence and were like, oh, but Naomi's going to be there and she's in the championship match for the SmackDown Women's title. Take my money.
They had to sell those 500 extra tickets that was still available. Those 500 tickets, so they can get that 75,000.
Yeah, universal fact. They didn't sell out immediately.
Alexa Bliss, I'm actually became a big fan of hers on SmackDown the last few months. I really enjoyed her. I like her look and just the way she wrestles. I don't like how they treated Mickey James. No. I hope she excels on Raw, but I don't like... I was a big fan of her when she was...
Like, you're booking her 22. Like the Dudley Boys, where you're supposed to know who they were for what they used to do, but you're not giving them the opportunity to show you what they can still do. That is an improvement on what they were already great at in the first place. And that's why I have hopes with the Hardys is if you bring in the broken thing, that'll be much better than Hardy Boys version 15. I want to see them advance. The Dudleys had separately done things and then as a tag team had done some great things since their WWE days. When they came back, they were one step above the Shining Stars. They were used to put over Cesaro and Sheamus and the New Day. That didn't serve a purpose.
How long do you think Naomi's going to hold the belt for? When does Charlotte take it from her?
Not for a while, because Charlotte's turning face right now.
Okay, well, she got beat down by a bunch of heels.
Yeah, and Becky and Naomi kind of saved her tonight. So I would assume this goes to a 3-on-3. at the next pay-per-view. And then that'll lead into either between that or just after that, Natalya versus Naomi. Natalya wins, and then Charlotte wins it off of Natalya.
Which Backlash is right now on paper, so far, one of the worst pay-per-views ever.
Yeah.
But we'll get into that at another time. Because we have to get to the main event. The next John Cena, Roman Reigns, defeated the beloved Undertaker.
You're missing the headline. There was one big part of this that we haven't mentioned yet.
Enlighten me.
Jim Ross was welcome back to commentary.
And being all serious, you know, what happened, our hearts go out to Jim Ross and what happened. So I'm glad that he did come back.
Yeah, and it's call, not a one-time deal, so.
To call Taker's last match the way it should be. JR is the best again, in the biz.
That's one of those things, like with Bruno, with Goldberg coming back, with so many of these people that maybe we thought those bridges are burned. No, to see him back, especially that the deal was in place before what unfortunately happened with Jan, but for him to have that to go back to in the middle of that crisis, that's a wonderful thing for that.
Yeah, try to get his mind off things of what's happened. So it's great to have JR back, but Roman Reigns and Undertaker again. Ugh.
It was what it was. Undertaker's too hurt because of the hip. I don't like how it was laid out. I don't like that finish with the back and forth for the final spear. I don't know if you've ever seen that. That was one of the moves that the Hart Foundation used to do, except it wasn't the spear, it was the lariat.
Yep.
And when they first were running it, when they first came to the company, and Brett misses.
He missed?
Yeah, a couple of times. I saw some footage just the last week. It's comical how bad it looks. And that's what that looked like. Is it Undertaker looked like he was hurt, but he was soldiering on. But that last move, he looked like he was out of it and like an old man in the street. Go, where's my house? Have you seen my wife? Kind of thing. Is he's standing there and Roman passes him. And then he's standing there waiting for it and Roman passes him. So he turns around and then Roman passes him. And he turns and he gets speared. Like, it was ridiculous.
I thought it was the Ultimate Warrior Hulk Hogan crisscross.
No, the worst part is there's a, I apologize, I don't remember it offhand, but there's an animator that does predictions for wrestling shows, and every single one of the matches, he then draws in, because he's talking like Mario, he's like, Mamma Mia, it's Roman Reigns, and he's the new SmackDown Women's Champion, and it's always, he runs the ropes, spear, hoorah, Superman punch, and he pins him, so... I just thought it was funny that they literally ended the show with that guy's prediction.
I wish they would have turned him heel. I understand why Vince McMahon won't, because he'll sell a lot more merchandise.
Are we going to get into that?
As Roman as a face. We're in it.
Okay. He's already a heel.
Explain.
He's a smart mark heel.
Explain.
It's new because we're not used to them directly booking for us and not acknowledging it. Not flat out acknowledging it where they go, oh, it's a very vocal but very small percentage of our fan base. They're very active, they're very loud, but they don't account for maybe 2-3% of the fan base. They're the only ones who are really complaining, but his merchandise sales are so big and he's this and he's that. And I'm sure he's up there because I do hear the women and the kids popping when he gets the intros and stuff like that.
So but they want to have his baby.
But it's the John Cena thing of half the crowd or more hates him. The other part loves him. So you get the let's go Cena, Cena sucks kind of thing. That's what Roman's getting. I think they noticed that with Cena, and I think that they are purposely booking Roman the way they do.
Because it worked out for Cena?
Cena stayed on top.
Part of that's you
don't listen to it. But that's also part of where you're getting our interest. Because let's be honest, there's times where we wonder about things and we go, are they finally going to turn him heel? And so what do? We get all anxious of, this is when they finally listen to us. And so we tune in. We're going to the show. We're paying attention, which is what gives them their money. And then they don't do it. And then we go, God damn it, they don't know. They're running this company into the ground and they should have booked it this way. And we all do podcasts or whatever and complain about it hours on end. And then we go to the next pay-per-view, and we go, oh my God. The way they're booking Braun, and Braun is over, and everybody's cheering him.
He goes out there and tells, I'm going to throw Kalisto in this trash can, just like I throw all of you pieces of garbage in it too. And they're all still cheering him because they hate Roman so much. And we go, oh my God, Braun's going to be the new babyface of the company and Roman's going to have to go heel to defeat him. And then they're not going to do it. And we're going to go, oh my God, what are they? Oh, they're fucking nuts. Why don't they do this? And then the next pay-per-view happens and we go, oh, this is it. They're going to turn him heel because we've all been, we're booing even more than the last time. They're certainly going to hear us. And they don't care because they got more money and they keep booking him and the kids are still buying his merchandise.
We're making our voices heard.
He's a hero. He's being painted as a hero to them, but to us, he's the villain. So they're working both. I think that that's what they're trying to do. Maybe I'm trying to make an excuse for a bad situation, but I'd like to think that they do know some things and maybe they found a way to finally work us, because part of being a smart mark is you're still a mark. You're still not part of the show. You're just watching it. We think that we know more than we actually do. We think that we have more say, or we should have more say, and we don't, and we're not going to. So they're reminding us, and they're reminding us in the way where we are feeding it ourselves. Because I'll tell you, what would happen if you turned Roman heel? We'd all start cheering him. Oh, we're so happy because I want to see Roman. I want to see him go out there and be a badass and spear motherfuckers. And he'd become a face because we'd all be cheering him.
He'll be the next Rock.
We want a cool heel. Yeah, exactly.
He'd be the next Rock. The Rock went heel with the Nation of Domination, became too cool. Then he went face heel. You can do whatever he wants. But I truly believe Roman Reigns could be the next Rock.
He could.
If he's done. If he turns.
He could, but they don't want him to go to Hollywood. So they're keeping him in his niche where he'll be comfortable. And part of that is not giving us what they want. But also, they get to control every aspect of this, that whatever they do, they win. The kids buy everything. We pay for our tickets or their tickets, and we're all watching, and we're doing all of it. And the best part is Roman's not even being really degraded. He gets booed, but what's behind it? What's all the discussion? The company is not utilizing him right. If they would put him in that position where he was the top heel, he'd be the next Rock. None of this is ever, that guy fucking sucks, he can't work, he's gonna kill somebody, get him off the fucking show. Nope. We're all going, he's the future. I want him. I just want him in a slightly different role. He should be the bad guy. He should be the horrible dictator that comes through and he's spearing people for no reason. And they don't give it to us. And what do? We boo him to try to say, boo, because Vince isn't on screen, but it's meant for you. CM Punk.
That's what I felt about Cena, though, when he started his rise, as in his five moves of doom. I was not impressed. WrestleMania 22 made Triple H tap. WrestleMania 23 made Shawn Michaels tap. Like, that is fucking bullshit.
Yeah.
And then how they're forcing John Cena down our throats as a super Cena. And then he just kept going on this roll, winning all these titles. Like, no.
But it worked. And we keep talking about the company and how they're doing things, and they want him to be the next John Cena. Yeah, they do. They want him to be on top for 10 years. And then as he starts to transition, he's doing outside projects, but he still comes back. He still puts on matches. And even if we hate him, we still go, yeah, but you can't knock his work ethic. He's one of the busiest guys. All that time that he spends on Make-A-Wish, and he's doing the Today Show, and he flies to the other side of the country to be in the main event of Raw that night. I mean, this guy is a badass.
He's put on great matches. Him and Styles, incredible.
Yeah.
Incredible, in which we were at the Money in the Bank.
Yep.
Pay-per-view. We're a fourth row at ringside. Yeah. I got AJ Styles sweat on my face.
I thought you weren't going to tell that story.
Oh, I haven't washed
since. He's a married man. Leave him out.
Since last June, I've not washed my face. Use a mask. But Undertaker had his farewell. Even though last year, didn't he put his gloves on the mat? But it wasn't televised. But here, it was televised, had his farewell. Time to go. Put Roman Reigns over.
No, but the moment you were looking for is they could have even done that same match at the very end when Undertaker walks halfway up the ramp or a quarter of the way up the ramp because it was so long. And he puts the hand up and he turns his head back to look at the crowd one last time. If Roman had speared him right then, we would have got what the smart marks want, which is that's clearly Roman's
a heel.
That would have been the perfect way and would have got booed completely. He would have been completely over as a heel. They didn't do that and they could have. This was respect. Retiring the Undertaker is literally the easiest way to turn the crowd against them. And they didn't do it, which should tell you that for whatever reason, whether I'm right or what we all fear is the truth, is that Vince doesn't know what he's doing. It doesn't matter. That's what the plan is.
We'll see. So that was our 50-minute reactions to WrestleMania. It was a 5-hour
show, at least.
It was over 7 hours, 2-hour pre-show. And then the actual pay-per-view was about 5 hours and 10 minutes, 5:15. So over 7 hours and 10 minutes of WrestleMania. I thought last year's was fucking long, but this beat it for the longest wrestling show I have ever seen. I actually read it was the longest wrestling show in the history of North America ever. But wow, they need to fucking find a way to control this length of time because people are dead. By the end of the show, people are dead for Triple H, Roman Reigns, mm-hmm. even though they didn't give a shit about it because they knew Roman Reigns was winning and they were fucking pissed. And here, Roman Reigns, Taker, they were dead. It's so hard to get that crowd for 7 hours because some of them, actually the pre-show, there was a lot of people were there. And previous years, it's always half. I know last year in Dallas, they had troubles getting them in their yeah. seats, but that's fucking long. And I just don't want a great match to be ruined if they save it for the end. If they save next year AJ Styles, Seth Rollins, which would tear the house down. And it's the last match and people are going to be so fucking tired to give the match its due with the crowd. That's just my concern. What do you think about the length of WrestleManias these days?
I don't see how they can minimize it, though. When you consider how many guys that they want to try to get the spotlight to, even if you took 5 minutes off of every match on average, you'd still have a 4-hour main show and still have the 2 hours of pre-show. Because remember, a lot of that pre-show is recap videos and stuff, and then there's usually 2, maybe 3 matches, right? So,
because you had 10 matches on the actual card and then 3 matches on the pre-show, so a total of 13 matches, and then
it was 14. You're missing one there.
So they had 13 or 14 matches around there. It's still a shitload.
Yeah.
It's just long. I guess it's something I just need to prepare myself for 7 hours.
No, it's too much. Especially when you consider Hall of Fame, NXT TakeOver, WrestleMania.
That entire weekend.
Raw, SmackDown. Then you're back into, well, I guess they had already taped NXT. And they already taped 205 before SmackDown. So, but still, that's just too much. It burns them out, and they're gonna do that at least 4 times a year. Except you won't have the Hall of Fame ceremony except at WrestleMania. But you'll still have Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. That's too much. And that's a lot of those are the core audience for the other 3 of the Big 4. So they're also people that could be like me that are watching Ring of Honor, and they are watching NXT. And they are watching 205, although I don't. But they're watching Impact, although I don't.
Sunday Night Heat.
No. Nobody watched Sunday Night Heat.
I did.
You're the guy. You're
the guy. I'm the guy. I'm that guy.
Your Xbox was happy about that.
So those are our reactions to WrestleMania. It took us a month. It needed a month to soak it in, get our true thoughts and feelings, what we thought about WrestleMania. Because it's still going on right now. So we had to wait until the show ended for us to give our reactions.
Just finished like 15 minutes ago.
If Undertaker's still coming down the ramp. It took an entire month for him to come down.
They needed those trolleys like they had at the Rumble. Oh. But they didn't want to show on camera for some reason. I remember that. The WrestleMania, was it 3? Where they had the big blue... like
6.
The
3 and 6.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Except the Warrior, he didn't take it. He was too cool on WrestleMania 6. He was the only guy. He ran
when you
down.
Have the blood of the warrior running through you, you don't need that stupid contraption.
He was huffing and puffing. I'm surprised he even made it through that match. Huffing and puffing, just running through.
Because he ran a mile before he got there. Jesus.
So please let us know in the comments below what you felt about this year's WrestleMania and what you would have changed with the booking.